Hello friends, welcome to my channel. In my last lecture, we have discussed about year modeling. We have discussed about cardinality of the relationships, one to many, many to many, and one to one relationships. And after this conceptual modeling, while designing a database, first of all, we have to perform the conceptual modeling, and after that, relational modeling will be used as part of representational implementation model. We will be using relational modeling. In the conceptual modeling, we will be using ER model to represent the database design, and here in the relational model, we will be using relational tables for designing the database. So here in the relational modeling, first of all, we have to understand few terminologies. See, the thing is that the first one is relation. Here in relational modeling, relation is nothing but a table. Relation is nothing but a table, and tuple is nothing but a particular row. A particular row, for example, see, this is the table 1 Mr. Rao, 1K, 10th department, 2 Krish, 2K, 10th department, 3 Raj, 3K, is from 20th department. See, a tuple is nothing but a particular row in the database, in the relational table. So this particular thing is called as a particular tuple. So tuple is nothing but a row inside the relational table. And then attribute. Attribute is nothing but, for example, this is the employee table. In the employee table, we have four different attributes. One is employee ID, employee name, salary, and department. Here employee ID is one of the attributes. We have three more remaining attributes: employee name, salary, and department. So attribute is nothing but a column. Okay. Next one is domain. Domain is nothing but a set of values associated with the attributes. Set of values associated with attribute. Okay, for example, if you take the employee ID column, this is the domain which contains employee ID attribute with three values. Okay, with this in this domain, we have one particular attribute data where it have three rows. Okay, 1, 2, and 3 is the data. Okay, domain is nothing but a set of values associated with an attribute. Relational schema. Relational schema is nothing but the metadata of the table. Okay, relational schema is nothing but the metadata of the table. For example, in this employee table, we have employee ID, employee name, salary, and department. Okay, see, this is the actual data, but this metadata is called as relational schema. Okay, this metadata is called as relational schema. I mean, these are the headers. Okay, employee ID, employee name, salary, department are the headers. Next one is degree of in this employee table, anything is a domain. This is domain 1, domain 2, domain 3, domain 4. Either you can consider employee ID or employee name or salary or department. Okay, you can consider any particular column as domain with some set of values associated with it. And degree of relation. Degree of relation is nothing but number of attributes in a particular relational table. Okay, degree of relation is nothing but number of attributes. Okay, degree of relation is nothing but number of attributes. Okay. The next one is, these are the important terms we have to identify while discussing about relational modeling. And here, the next topic is relational constraints. Constraint is nothing but a condition. If you want to follow some model, you have to follow some conditions, right? So those conditions are relational constraints. We have four different relational constraints are there. One is domain constraint, key constraints, entity integrity constraint, and referential integrity constraint. We already discussed about domain. Okay, what is a domain? Domain is a set of values. Okay, set of values associated with an attribute. Okay, what does domain constraint explains? Domain constraints explains about make sure that there should be no composite. Okay, composite, comma, multi-valued attribute inside a relational table. Domain constraints takes care of composite attributes and multi-valued attributes. Okay, there should be no composite attributes and multi-valued attributes in relational table. Composite means a name can be in your modeling, one particular attribute can be derived. I mean, ER modeling allows composite attributes. Just like this is one attribute, first name, last name, middle name. Okay, ER modeling allows the composite attributes, but relational attribute, it won't allow the composite attributes. So that will be taken care by the domain constraint. Okay, so here we should not allow composite attribute. Next one is multi-valued attribute. Even multi-valued attributes also allowed in ER modeling, but domain in relational modeling, using domain constraint, will restrict the multi-valued attribute. For example, a phone number. Okay, we will be having, I mean, in general, people will be having multiple phone numbers. So there is a possibility for multiple values for one particular column. So that will be, these two things will be taken care by domain constraints. The next one is key constraints. Next one is key constraints. Okay. What is a key, first of all? A key is used for identifying a tuple. Okay, a key is used for identify the unique value, uniqueness of the table. Okay, a key is used for identifying the uniqueness of a table. First of all, there are different kinds of keys. First, let us discuss about primary key. For example, we have a table called employee. Okay, this is the data. Some junk data. So if you want to identify a particular tuple uniquely, any particular tuple uniquely, you should be defining a primary key on top of the table. See, by using this employee name, okay, can we identify the any particular tuple uniquely? Why? Because, for example, there is another employee with the same name, Prasad, saying that. Okay, so by using the employee name, you cannot identify any tuple in this table uniquely. So there will be a possibility for duplicate. Okay, so salary, there are chances for duplicate because two employees might be having the same salary. Okay, third one is department. there are chances for duplicates in department also, because many employees belongs to the same department. So here there is a column called employee ID column, which where there is no possibility for duplicates. Okay, so using that table you can identify any particular row uniquely. For example, if you want to fetch the details of Prasad, so which Prasad? Because there are two employee IDs available. Okay, if you want to perform any updates for this employee, you cannot write any SQL query, or else you cannot identify that particular data item. So for that, if you have a primary key or key value defined on top of the table, by using this key value, you can identify uniquely that in that particular tuple will be identified uniquely, and any kind of operations will be performed very easily. Okay, any kind of operations will be performed very easily by using a primary key. So this primary key should not contain any duplicates. So it's a unique value, and it is not a null value. It will not allow null values as well as it is a unique value. Okay, this is a primary key, and let me explain about candidate key. See, what is a candidate key? Even candidate key also useful for identify the table uniquely. Okay, even candidate key also useful for identifying the table, I mean any particular tuple uniquely. What is the difference between primary key and candidate key? Even both the primary key and candidate key are same, but there is possibility for some tables, for some data items, there might be chances for more than one primary key. Okay, there are some chances for having more than one primary key. For example, I'll give you an example. Some vehicle table. Okay, register number, vehicle name, engine number. Okay, so here some bench, Maruti, you can write any particular vehicle name. Even the engine numbers also different. So if you consider this particular table, both register number and engine number, both are eligible as primary key. Okay, if you consider this particular table, both in register number and engine number are eligible as primary keys, but you will be considering any one of them as a primary key. So the number of keys other than the primary key, the keys which are eligible as primary key is called as candidate key. So if you consider register number as primary key, so engine number will be a candidate key. Okay, even this is also eligible, engine number also eligible as a primary key. So this is what candidate key means. The next one is, the very important thing is super key. See, there are some possibilities in a particular table. We might not find any primary key. Number, department number, Okay, for this HR department, some manager is there, some Rao, accountant is some X, some finance department, some Shah, accountant is Mr. Y. For same HR department, there could be the same manager, Z is the accountant. See, there are some cases, okay, we will not find a single attribute as a primary key. So in that case, what we will be doing? So there is no such key for this. We can call this as a weak entity. While discussing about ER modeling, I told you, if a particular entity doesn't contain any key, then it is called as weak entity. In such cases, what we will do, we will be considering multiple attributes, we will be combining multiple attributes, okay, we will be combining multiple attributes and consider it as primary key. That is called super key. The combination of multiple attributes, the combination of multiple attributes becomes a key, then it is called as super key. In this table, what is a super key? Department name, comma, accountant. With this combination, you can identify this particular table, any particular tuple, uniquely. Okay, you can consider the combination of department name and the accountant as a key. So this key is called as super key. Okay, this key is called as super key. And one more thing you have to remember, even I explained while explaining ER modeling, while identifying a super key, you should not consider the maximum attributes. You should consider as minimum as possible. For example, this table have three columns. Okay, if you merge all these three columns, okay, even though by merging all these three columns, you can identify each tuple uniquely, but with the department number and accountant itself, I mean the minimum number of, using the minimum number of attributes also, you can identify a super key. Okay, we have to consider as minimum as possible. The number of attributes should be as minimum of as possible. So the minimal super key is equivalent to a key of a particular relational table. The minimal super key is equivalent to the key for a particular relational table. So this is about key constraint. We have discussed about what is a key, what is a primary key, what is a candidate key, and what is a super key. Okay, so the next thing is that entity integrity, we can define such some constraints based on entity integrity, but the major entity integrity constraint will be not null. Okay, for example, you can define a particular table. In that particular table, sometimes a particular column, for example, like department number, you can define this entity integrity constraint on top of any particular attribute. Okay, so that particular attribute should not be accepting any null values. Okay, for example, you defined not null for employee name. While inserting the data, you cannot insert a null value for that employee name. Okay, it should contain a value. Okay, entity integrity explains about not null constraint. You cannot enter any null values if you define entity integrity constraint on top of any such attribute. Okay, this is called entity integrity constraint. Next one is referential integrity. Okay, referential integrity means it's a primary key and foreign key relationship. You might aware of SQL. Universal table, this is employee ID, employee name, and department ID, department number, department name. Okay, these are the two entities, employee table and department table. So what here, employee ID is a unique value, I mean it's a primary key, and here department ID is one more column, which is, I mean here department table, department number is a primary key column, but it is referring the values from department ID of employee table. Okay, department number is a key column which is referring the values from department ID. Here this is a parent table, employee is a parent table, and this is child table. Okay, child table, if it contains 10, 20, 30, 40 as values, child table should contain the values from its parent itself. Okay, it cannot contain any value other than its parent table. Okay, as parent table contains 10, 20, 30, 40, it should contain in between, I mean one of the values, 10 or 20 or 30 or 40. Okay, it cannot have any such value like 50 or 60, because it's referential integrity. It is having primary key and foreign key relationship with employee and department table. That's why it should have the values from its parent table only. So this is called referential integrity. Referential integrity is explaining about foreign keys. So these are the relational constraints. Let us discuss one more time. Domain integrity explains about multi-valued attributes and composite attributes. It will restrict them. Key constraint is nothing but primary key and the key values as primary key or super key or candidate key. Uniqueness, simply you can say that uniqueness of the particular table. You can simply say uniqueness. What is entity integrity? Entity integrity explains about not null constraint, and referential integrity explains about primary key and foreign key relationship. So this is very important. Sometimes I will be asking, domain integrity explained about what? So multi-valued or composite, they will be giving not null constraint and foreign key. So you should identify that. So these are the different relational constraints we have. Next one, what will happen if you violate such constraints? For example, these are the relational constraints we have. Okay, domain integrity, key integrity, entity integrity, and referential integrity. Okay, what are all the maximum operations we can perform on top of data? Either insert we can perform, update we can perform, and delete we can perform. Okay, insert, update, and delete, these are the operations we can perform on top of the data. Okay, first of all, while performing insert, is there any chances for let us check entity integrity, referential integrity. While performing insert operation, are there any chances for violating the domain integrity? Domain integrity means inserting multiple values for a single value, or else composite values. So for example, there is a column called a name column. You might try to insert composite value, composite attribute. So there is a chance for violating the domain integrity while performing insert. Key constraint, you might try to insert a null value, or you might try to insert a duplicate. For example, employee ID is there, you have already inserted one, some data is there, you again try to insert with the same value. Okay, there are chances for violating the key constraint. Okay, you understand? You already have a value for employee ID 1, employee ID as 1, again you try to insert another value, employee ID as 1. Here employee ID is a primary key which is performing uniqueness on top of the employee ID field. So if you try to insert a duplicate value, okay, it will violate the key constraint. Okay, next one is entity integrity. While inserting the data, you might try to insert, some student name is there, you might try to violate that, I mean By inserting a null value, you might try to violate the constraint. There are possibilities for violating entity integrity also. And referential integrity. As just now I told you, parent table contains 20, 30, but in the child table, you try to insert 40. This is called violating the referential integrity. Okay, this is called referential integrity. So there are for all these constraints can be violated while performing the insert operation. So for this, to resolve all such issues, the simple solution is reject that particular data, whatever you are trying to insert, na, simply reject it. Don't accept for inserting the data. Okay, next one is update. While performing update, let us check, are there any possibilities for violating these relational constraints. Okay, and domain integrity. Domain integrity explains about this thing, right? Multi-valued attribute. Is it possible to violate domain integrity while performing update operation? No. Okay. It's possible because there is a value available. For example, employee name is there. It's having simple attribute, but you try to insert a composite attribute just like this. While performing update, instead of this, you are trying to insert this. So there may be chances for violating the domain integrity. Next, key integrity. Even key integrity also, you might try to insert duplicate values. So it's possible. So entity integrity, you might try to insert null values. It's possible. Referential integrity. Even here also, you can try to update the data using the, you might try to violate the conditions of referential integrity. There are possibilities. Okay. Even though it have the parent table data, you might try to update with other than the parent table data. So it is called violation. So even update also having the all the possibilities for domain integrity, key integrity, entity integrity and referential integrity. Even here also, simply by rejecting the data, we can solve these issues. Okay, by simply rejecting the data, whatever is violating the constraints is a solution. Next one is delete. Domain integrity, key integrity, entity integrity and referential integrity. Okay, domain integrity means multi-valued or composite attribute. Okay, while performing deleting the data, is it possible to violate this? Because you are not trying to insert anything or you are not trying to update anything. So domain constraints cannot be violated using the delete operation, because delete can't be do that, right? Delete operation is for removing the data from the database. Okay, you can remove the data from database. That's it. You cannot insert anything or modify anything. So in the case of delete operation, domain constraints cannot be violated. Next one is key constraint. Even in key constraints also, it's not possible, because key constraint can be violated if you try to insert any duplicate data. Okay, if you try to insert any duplicate data. So as you are not inserting anything, you are simply removing the data. It is not possible. Okay, even entity integrity also not possible. Why? Because you are not inserting anything. So you cannot violate the entity integrity also. But the final thing is referential integrity. Referential integrity is possible. You are violating the conditions of referential integrity while performing a delete operation. I will explain you how. How means, as I told you, employee and department, this is the parent table, this is the parent. Child table contains department table, department number and department name. For example, 10, 10, 20. Okay, 10, 20, some HR, some finance. This is the table. While performing delete operation, you are trying to delete this particular row. Okay, while performing delete, you are trying to perform this particular row. If you delete the data from primary table, actually the child contains the same value. This is the reference for this record. This is the reference. So it should not contain, if you want to have this value in the child table, it should present in the parent table. If you remove this particular record, you will violate the referential integrity. Why? Because there is no reference. 20 should be present in the parent table, then only you can use that value in the child table. So you will be violating the referential integrity. To solve this particular cases while performing delete for referential integrity, there are two options: on delete cascade, okay, on delete set null. On delete cascade and on delete set null. What will on delete cascade will do? On delete cascade, what it will do? On delete cascade, what will do? If you remove this particular data, it will remove complete data from even from the child tables also. And set null will do, if you remove this particular tuple, it will set null in the child table. So by using these two particular solutions, we can solve the issues with the referential integrity. So by using these three operations, we have just discussed about what are the possibilities of violating the relational constraints. Okay, thank you. Thanks for watching.